Well, good evening, everyone. Good evening. We're going to give them just a second because I see everybody's still in the homework line. Thank y'all for being here tonight. We're going to kind of have, I guess, a late Thanksgiving celebration tonight. And we're going to do like traditional Thanksgiving food and have pizza for you guys. For those of you that didn't want to have to carve up a turkey, we're going to spare you from that. But what the flow is going to be tonight will be a little bit different. So we don't have any music tonight. That's kind of Brandon's fault, all right? And I have permission to throw him under the bus for that. Because the reason we're kind of a skeleton crew tonight is most of the staff on the church, they're at their annual meeting where they go over what worked for 2022 and what do we need to do different for 2023. So that's the reason some of the normal faces you guys see aren't here tonight. They're all in that meeting together. So you get what you get and you don't throw a fit. That's what we tell our kids, all right? I'm going to do the best I can for you. So what the flow tonight will be, there'll be no music. Like I said, I'm going to bring the word to you. We're going to pray, and then we're going to eat. And what we'll do is when this is over with, since we won't have any class time, we'll let the ladies go first, get in line, because there's way fewer of them than there are men. And if we send y'all first, some of them may not be able to eat, because I've seen how y'all are at some functions, how y'all stack them plates up. I've seen little baby Gronk with a plate in each hand before, so I know how you'll do them. So we're going to let ladies go first when this is over with. But like I said, this is just the Journey Church. This is Brandon. This is the Regeneration Program. Just wanted to give you guys a chance to break bread together in honor of the Thanksgiving holiday, because I know, like y'all, I can think of a whole lot of reasons that I need to be thankful. All right, so let's open up tonight in prayer. And if anybody brought your Bible, if you want to go ahead and mark it to Colossians chapter 1. Colossians chapter 1. We'll go to the Lord in prayer. Our God and our Father, we love you and we thank you for the opportunity to get together tonight and worship the only thing worthy of our worship in this universe, Father, and that is you. You made us. You bought us with a price. You love us. You provide for us. We have so many things, Father, to be thankful for that we can say they only come from you. So, Father, we want to publicly declare our thankfulness that you would love us, that you would send your Son to die for us, that you would provide for us, whether that be clothes on our back or roof over our head or food in our belly. Father God, you provide for us faithfully, and we want to say thank you. I ask that you'd be with me as I bring the word this morning or this evening. Father, I ask that those that be here that do not know you, that maybe tonight will be the night that you soften a heart and a seed is planted and you call a child home to be what was born a child of wrath into a heir to your kingdom. Father, we love you. We pray these things in the holy name of Christ Jesus. Amen. All right. Colossians. Have y'all had a chance to find it yet? Colossians chapter 1, we're going to be in verses 21 and 22 today. Now, most of the time, writing your intro for a sermon is the easiest part of getting a sermon put together. If you're going to go, especially if you're going to guest preach somewhere, you're going to fill in. It might be your home church and you're just filling in to give the lead pastor a break, or he's sick, or he's on vacation, or you've been asked to come speak to another church. Normally, your intro is by far the easiest part. But the intro on this one, I typed out and I deleted and I typed out and I deleted. And I probably did that 8 or 10 times to the point of having honest writer's block where I could not get an intro to match my sermon. An intro does you no good if it doesn't set up what you're about to take people through as far as what you're teaching them about the word. And it was Friday, and my wife and my son had went down to Tuscaloosa for a football game. I'm not an Alabama fan. Don't hold that against me. That's their doings. But it's me and my daughter left. And my daughter sees me working. And she comes and she's like, Daddy, Daddy, I want a snack. I want a snack now. I said, okay, well, I'll get you a snack. I'll take a break. I'm not getting anywhere anyway. So I got up with my daughter. I got her little snack cup out. I made her some popcorn. And while I'm waiting on the popcorn, I'm thinking like, Father, please give me something. I mean, I need help. I'm not getting anywhere fast on this intro. And it finally dawned on me the reason why I can't get anywhere on this intro. Because tonight we're going to talk about forgiveness. I know last week Nick talked to you guys some about forgiveness. And a lot of what Nick talked about was forgiveness, what we would call laterally, right? Forgiveness from person to person. But today we're going to talk about forgiveness horizontally, what it looks like, God's forgiveness to us. And it dawned on me why I can't get an intro. And it's that God's forgiveness is so big, it's so perfect, it's so far beyond what we know about forgiveness that we don't have the words for it and we don't have the mental capacity to really understand how big and how perfect God's forgiveness really is. And I know that kind of sounds like, man, that's what you came up with. But I need you guys to understand how big God's forgiveness is. And we're going to talk about that today. And you may hear some things that cause you to reflect on some of the worst of the worst things you've done in your life. And I did that on purpose, but it's not to put you in a bad place. It's that you might leave here knowing how big and how perfect God's forgiveness really is. See, we understand forgiveness like to each other, like person to person, right? We understand, we know we're all flawed people. Even for the unbeliever in the room, you know you're going to mess up. Your bunk mate's going to mess up. Your neighbor's going to mess up. Your mama's going to mess up. Your sister's going to mess up. And we're going to forgive each other. But just like we're flawed, we're not perfect people, our forgiveness to each other is flawed, right? You can't expect flawed people to do something perfectly. That would be very unfair. So we don't really all the way understand in the way we relate forgiveness to the way he relates forgiveness. And that's going to be the point of tonight's message. God's forgiveness towards us, if we belong to Christ, it's different because it's pure and it's holy. And it's forgiveness that's bought with a price that you and I, one, will never truly comprehend on this side of eternity. And two, it's a price that if you were asked to pay it, you could never write the check. So tonight, I want to do the best I can to show you two things. One is, what do we need forgiveness for? It's important. If you don't understand why you need forgiveness, what good is forgiveness? And two, where and how does this forgiveness come? So those are the two things we want to do today. If you would stand for the reading of God's Word, we're going to read Colossians chapter 1, verses 21 and 22. Colossians 1, 21 and 22. Verse 21 says, "And you, who once were alienated and hostile in mind, doing evil deeds, he has now reconciled in his body of flesh by his death in order to present you holy and blameless and above reproach before him." This is the word of the Lord. We say thanks be to God. You guys can be seated. So, verse 21 in Colossians, and it's always kind of weird when you take two or three verses, like just a chunk of scripture from the middle of a book. Or in this case, it's the first chapter of the book, but still it's the middle of the chapter, so you don't really have the context of what's being said. See, verse 21 is a hard shift from what those first 20 verses are in the book of Colossians. See, in Colossians 1, Paul is opening up a letter to the church. And this letter, for the first 20 chapters, is speaking about everything in a very general sense. Like what Christ has done for the world. What God has done for the world. How the world has fell short of God's glory. Everything is spoken about in this big, encompassing, umbrella-type sense, right? Well, in 21, there's a hard shift. And that shift comes from speaking of everything in this big context to Paul's narrowing down to the individual reader.
So if you start in Colossians 1 and you're paying attention to what you're reading, you're going to get to verse 21 and you're going to go, something's different. He changed directions on me. And it's important that we understand that, because what Paul's doing there by that is saying, yes, all this applies in this big general sense, but even more important than this big general sense is it applies to you as the individual. We think a lot about the body of Christ, the big C church, and those are great and important things, but we have to be careful that we don't let our faith be about the big, that we don't forget that our faith is about you and it's about him. It is an individual, it is a personal faith, and that's what Paul is talking about here. So in verse 21, Paul is writing, or he's getting away from that general application sense and is now focused on what Christ has done, or he has been focused on what Christ has done for the world and his chosen people, and now he's focusing on the individual. Verse 21 is taking a sharp turn from the world to the individual. So in verse 21, Paul's first charge of the individual is to show us where we stand in relation to God's law. He's trying to make sure that the reader, that you understand from an individualistic standpoint where you, not we, where you stand in relation to God's perfect law. He's trying to make this personal. He says that we were alienated and hostile in mind, doing evil deeds. He's talking about me. He's not talking about us. He's saying, Bo, you were hostile in mind and you did evil deeds against God. He's talking about my son. He's talking about my wife. He's talking about you as an individual, and it's important that we grasp this, because without grasping this, you don't really understand why you need the forgiveness of God. Kind of a theological term for you that Paul's talking about here, we would call this total depravity. Paul is speaking to man's condition that he's born into through the curse of Adam outside of the finished work of Christ. Now, thanks be to God, we can escape that through putting our faith and our trust in Christ Jesus, but we're all born, down to my sweet little four-year-old, or about to be four-year-old out there, we're all born hostile in mind toward God. The alienating that Paul is talking about in verse 21 is worse than any feeling of loneliness you could imagine. This isn't separation from your friends or even separation from your family. What Paul is talking about is separation from the actual love of God. It's important that we get this. You will never be separated from God, because God is everywhere. God is all powerful. He's all encompassing. You will never be separated from God. What you will be, though, is you'll be separated from his love. And when we're separated from his love, we're in a very dangerous place. This also isn't a separation Paul's talking about for some certain amount of time. Like, if you do this, you're going to have X number of years. Paul is talking about an eternal separation from the love of God. This is alienation. This is being cut off from the love of the Creator that gave you life. Being eternally separated from the love of God means you are eternally connected to the wrath of God. See, we don't escape God either way. The question is, do we belong to Him and we receive His love, or are we His enemy and we receive His wrath? Next, Paul, in this verse 21, Paul uses the word hostile. And I'm here to tell you that hostile is one of those words that in our modern language, we don't give this word the credit that it deserves, the power that it deserves. We read this word and kind of think like, oh yeah, he doesn't like him, he's hostile. No, that's not what hostile means. Hostile means that you are going, you are being active against your enemy. Hostile means that you're making a concentrated effort to oppose or to block your enemy. These are actions. These are made with purpose and intent. These aren't passive. These are purposeful actions. See, hostile means you go out of your way to fight your enemy. And Paul is saying that outside of the finished work of Christ, we are hostile against God. Think about that for a second. If you don't belong to Christ Jesus, you're still hostile to God. And God will eternally punish you for that hostility. This is where we go back to the individual. We got to get out of this group think and back to the individual. That outside of you belonging to Christ Jesus, you are actively opposing and fighting the will of God. See, we have to understand these things to understand what we need forgiveness from. Our obedience, our will is directly tied to our minds. You know, Paul's what Paul, somebody said, you're hostile in mind. So our will is tied to that mind. There's never a second that you're alone away from your mind. Like when I say alone, I mean like alone in just body and the mind's not there. The mind's always there. The mind's always working. Even in your sleep, you're being swayed left and right to take certain actions or to think about certain things. You're never without your mind. So if your mind is hostile to God, how can your body, how can your will, how can your actions deviate from that hostility of your mind? But there's a huge hope in the beginning of verse 21. And many of us would skim right past it. If you've got your Bibles opened, look at the beginning of verse 21, and Paul says that those who once were. See, the people reading this letter, they would have been reading this for the first time in roughly 50 to 60 AD. So you're looking in that 25, 30 years after the death of Christ. In that time period, they're no different than you and I. These people, they need to understand God's holy word. They need faith in Christ Jesus, and they need to know that there is hope that goes beyond any sin issue that they have. Remember, they're hostile in mind. They need hope. They need to know, how do I get past this hostility? And that's what Paul is writing this letter to the church about. They need the hope that a problem so big that they cannot solve it, the problem that is the wages of sin being your eternal death, that big of a problem, they need to know that where they can't resolve it, there's a creator of the universe who can. See, we will never understand the miracle of our grace that has been given to us by God until we understand that we were his enemy. How big is the love of God if he just saves a bunch of people that already loved him first anyway? Where's the miracle of the gospel? If God just set aside a couple of perfect people and he's like, yeah, I'll just love them because they love me first. That's nowhere in your Bible. In your Bible it says we were enemies of God. And he loved his people so much that he would overcome their hatred for him. He would make them new in mind. Until we understand this, until we understand that we were born enemies of God, trying our hardest to slap the face of the very creator that gave us life, we'll never understand how blessed we are by the hand of the Almighty, that he would reach down and he would touch not us, he would touch you. He would say, you, I'm I'm going to reconcile your mind. And I'm going to make you the individual. I'm going to make you right with me. See, when we understand that, that's when we start to understand the gospel. Because the gospel is the story of forgiveness. Verse 22 is another shift. Verse 21 was Paul making sure we understood what the problem is. Where verse 22 is Paul making sure we understand what the solution is. See, Paul's not a doom and gloom guy. Paul, there's a lot of Paul's writings that people are like, man, Paul's coming at you. And he does sometimes. But if you really read Paul's works, he never gives you the problem without showing you what the solution is. And that's what verse 22 is. We're shifting from problem to solution. Verse 22 says, he has now reconciled in his body of flesh by his death in order to present you holy and blameless and above reproach before him. Christ is who reconciles us. Paul is given credit where only credit can be due. Paul doesn't list any other thing that's tied to your reconciliation between your sinful past and your promised hopeful future. He ties nothing there except for Christ Jesus. Paul wants to make sure that you do not misunderstand this, that it's not Jesus plus something, that it's Jesus plus nothing that makes you right with God. But what does this word reconciliation really mean? That's not a word we like walk around and use all the time, right? Nobody's like at your job and like, man, I'm sorry we got into it at the break room. We should reconcile with each other. Like that's not our vocabulary. We don't use that word. So I had to ask the Google, what does reconciliation mean? What's the actual definition? And Google said that reconciliation means the restoration of friendly relationships or the action of making one view or belief compatible with another. I want to read that to you again. Listen to me, because you will not get the gist of this if you don't understand what reconciliation is. It says, one is the restoration of friendly relations, or, it gave a second sub-definition, the action of making one view or belief compatible with another. But in our case, I'm here to tell you that it's not one or the other. We don't have to pick between one or two, because God's version of reconciliation is both of those things. Remember that hostile in mind part we camped out on in verse 21 just a moment ago? That mind is being reconciled back to God. But it's not you doing it. It's Him doing it for you. He's drawing you back to Him. Your mind is being brought to view and belief that matches His view and belief. And see, we don't really like that part. There has to be, for reconciliation to happen, there has to be one of two things. Either our minds, our will, our actions are either brought to match His, which we don't like, or we try to get His to match ours. I'm guilty of that. I'll stand in a pulpit and tell you. I'm guilty of that. We all are if we're honest with ourselves. If we had to pick, if we're really being honest, we think, in our infinite wisdom, we think, man, life would be better if I could get His to match mine instead of mine matching His. We get the order wrong, and that's a bad place to get the order wrong. See, we crave so badly to be our own God. In our own hostile minds, we crave so badly that we would walk out of paradise and into pain just to say, you're not the boss of me. As we shake our fist at the sovereign God of the universe. And if that line flew over you, go read Genesis 3 in your Bible. Go read Genesis 3 and see how mankind walked out of paradise and into pain over the fact that we would rather be our own gods. We've been doing it ever since. We've done it today if we're honest with ourselves. But thank God for his reconciliation. But God being rich in mercy, he would take people like us, people who the Bible calls children of wrath, and through the finished work of Christ, he would reconcile our minds and hearts to be like his. This is the reconciliation that Paul is talking about in verse 22. Paul also tells us, don't flip over there now because we're only going to be over for a split second, but if you look in Romans 12, chapter 2, Paul tells the church of Rome, he says, do not be conformed to this world, but be transformed by the renewal of your mind. Remember, where my mind goes, my will follow. If I fill this full of things that stand against him, I'm a fool to think I'll do different. My body, my will go where my mind takes it. And we have to be aware of that. The other piece of that definition of reconciliation was to restore a friendly relationship. Remember the word relationship. And please understand what your personal relationship with God is outside of the finished work of Christ. Look, I know there's people in this room that you're here because you got to be here. I know there's people in this room that don't believe any of this, and you see all of this as a giant waste of time. And I want you to know you're still welcome here. You're absolutely welcome here. I'm proud that you're here. Whether you're here of your own accord or someone made you come, I just praise God that you're sitting in a chair. But even to you, the person that doesn't even believe in the existence of God, you have a relationship with him, whether you realize it or not. And if you really understood what that relationship was, it would make you tremble. It would bring fear upon you like you've never felt in your life, because your relationship with God is not a relationship of love. It's not a relationship of reconciliation. It's a relationship of his wrath meeting you for eternity. But to the born-again believer, man, your relationship, you've gone from enemy to friend. To the born-again believer, you've gone from wayward child to the first name listed in the family will if you belong to Christ Jesus. That's the reconciliation you have. You have been reconciled to the Father through the death of the Son. There was a price paid for your reconciliation. This is only accomplished through the death of Christ. Paul is talking about the cross right here when he makes the statement through his body into his death. That's what Paul's talking about, is the price that was paid for your reconciliation. And like I stated in my intro, it's a price that if you were ever asked to pay for it, you couldn't write the check. It may be a free gift to you, and praise God for it, that it was a free gift to me, but we should never make the mistake of thinking that gift was free to everyone, because it wasn't. Most of you guys and girls, y'all either been in county, or you've been in big boy jail, you've been in prison, and y'all all know the I didn't do nothings, I'm innocent. Remember, everybody in jail is innocent. Amen. Everybody in jail is innocent. Ain't never been nobody in jail that was supposed to be there, right? I mean, let's just be honest with each other. It was always my neighbor or my cousin, and I just happened to end up getting wrapped up in it, right? Because we like to think we understand what innocence is when we don't. There's only ever been one innocent man in the history of the world. It was falsely imprisoned, and he didn't do 6 months in county. He didn't do a decade in the pen. He was publicly mocked, beaten, spit on, nailed to a cross, hung, suffocated, and died, and then had a spear shoved in his side to pay for the reconciliation that Paul is talking about in verse 22. And that reconciliation, that's the reconciliation that Paul hopes he's saying to you when he says, you who once were. You either once were or you never will be. And that sounds harsh, but it's the truth. And when it comes to your soul and where you'll spend eternity, I love every one of you enough to stand up here and boldly tell you the truth that outside of the finished work of Christ Jesus, you will burn in hell for eternity. And I don't want that for anybody in the room. Neither does Paul. And that's why he's celebrating and he's making sure these people understand what he means when he says they have been reconciled through the death of the Son to the love of the Father. Verse 22, it ends with the biggest example of forgiveness the world's ever known. We have to remember that God doesn't forgive like we do. Boy, we love to put conditions. I know I do it. I put all kinds of conditions on my forgiveness. I'll forgive you if you'll right that wrong, if you give me that money back you took from me, if you'll fix that thing you broke in my house, I'll forgive you. Because that's how we forgive. We're flawed people. We flawly forgive each other. And that's not real forgiveness. God's forgiveness is total in nature. What God does is through the forgiveness accomplished, the reconciliation accomplished. I'll put an example for you. If I come to your house and I just really show my rear end, I knock your TV off the wall. Maybe I didn't mean to, maybe I did, but I knock your TV off the wall. I bust it up. There's a hole in the sheetrock. Even if I make it right, the next time you invite me to your house, I'm going to be that guy that broke your TV. You're going to look at me and you're going to keep an eye on me. You're going to make sure I don't get anywhere near that TV. You're going to have one of the biggest dudes in the house stay within arm's reach of me so he can snatch me up if need be. That's the way we forgive each other, right? Let's be honest about it. We're flawed people, so we forgive in a flawed manner. God doesn't forgive that way. God doesn't see, once you have been reconciled, God doesn't see the slightly better version of you. God doesn't see you 2.0. God doesn't see you and go, you broke my TV last time, but I'm going to let him back in the house. That's not how God forgives. God forgives you in a manner like Paul says in verse 22, that you have been reconciled, that you have been made new, that you have been above reproach. Paul is saying that God's forgiveness is so total, he doesn't even remember that you broke the TV. He doesn't remember it. And there's a reason why he doesn't remember it. Because if you have been reconciled through Christ Jesus, he doesn't see you anymore. He sees his Son in you. He doesn't see nasty, dirty Bo who's been made clean. He just sees clean. Because if I've experienced true reconciliation through the finished work of Christ Jesus, I've got a mirror standing right in front of me that's not shining what I used to be. It's shining what his Son has done for me. And it's important that we understand how that reconciliation works. This is the way God forgives. I want to give you three quick application points. The first one is if you're in Christ, you are commanded to give. Colossians chapter 3:13 says, bearing with one another, and if one has a complaint against another, forgive each other as the Lord has forgiven you, so you also must forgive. Think of all the things you've done to offend God. Think of what you've done today to offend God. And if you belong to Him, He's forgiven you for it. He's eternally forgiven you for it. So who are we to withhold forgiveness from someone else? That's a slap in the face to God. Number two is forgiveness is personal because our relationship with Christ is personal. John 15, 15 tells us that no longer do I call you servants, for the servant does not know what his master is doing, but I have called you friends. For all that I have heard from my Father, I have made known to you. Christ is telling us it's personal. He uses the word friends. Friendship is personal. Most of the time, forgiveness is really hard because of how personal the sin against you, the crime against you, the hate against you, how personal it was in nature. Most of the time, it's not some stranger that's made you mad. It's somebody you know and loves you, and you love them. And that's the reason forgiveness can get really hard. But ask yourself this: how personal was your sin against God? How many times have you knowingly give God the middle finger and said, I know you're real, but I'm not submitting to your law? We personally sin against Him, but He personally forgives us. So when we're commanded to forgive each other, it should be personal in nature. The last one is true forgiveness requires a sacrifice. Ephesians 1:7 tells us that in Him we have redemption through His blood, the forgiveness of our trespasses according to the riches of His grace. It took the shedding of blood for that forgiveness to come. That blood represents sacrifice. Now look, you may not ever be called to shed your blood, to break your bones, or give your life. You may never be called to do any of that, but you will be called to die to yourself. You will be called to forgive someone in a spot that's going to hurt your pride so bad you can't stand it. But guess what? If you belong to Him, you're commanded to give that forgiveness. So in closing, I want to take the time to make sure you understand what the gospel is, because the gospel is a message of forgiveness. That a perfect God would make an imperfect man, that man would disobey God's commands, that he would squander his paradise that God gave him, that man by his very nature is deserving of God's judgment and wrath. And that's where the forgiveness comes in. That a God who would create us would make a way to save us. God would offer forgiveness to the sinner through the life, the death, and the resurrection of His Son, Christ Jesus. The gospel literally means good news. Forgiveness being offered to those who would put their saving faith in Christ and bend the knee to His lordship, that is the good news. That's what's good about it. That forgiveness is the only thing that saves the sinner from an eternity of God's wrath and gives an eternity of His perfect love, is the forgiveness that is the gospel. So I beg you tonight to seek His forgiveness while you can. Be made right with God before this forgiveness is no longer an option. Let us pray. Our God and our Father, I thank You for the opportunity to bring Your word tonight. I pray that You are brought honor and glory through it. I pray that if anything was said that was not of Your will, that those words would fall to the floor and nobody would remember them, Father. And what truth You wanted delivered, Father, I pray that I faithfully did. I pray that You would use the words tonight to mold us, to shape us, to pierce our hearts of stone. Father, that we would understand how much in need of Your forgiveness we really are and what the price of that forgiveness really was. Father, I pray that You be with the food that's out in the lobby. I pray that this would be a joyful time of fellowship, a time of thanksgiving. Father, I pray that that conversations are had about more than just football and shopping. That tonight's message would weigh heavy on a heart and that those that do not know you would honestly seek your forgiveness. It's in the name of Christ I pray. Amen. All right, ladies, you are free to go first. And guys, don't worry, as soon as the last one crosses the threshold, y'all can go too.